of our series on belief. We have reached the end of this series. We spent 10 weeks talking about what we should believe. And the next 10 weeks we talked about how we should behave and act. And then the last 10 weeks we talked about who we should become as Christians. We started with a topic so broad, I couldn't believe they even really threw it out there as a sermon topic. Remember, the first week was about God. And I actually passed that on to Eric to preach about, if I remember correctly. But this week, we end with a topic so specific, it might have surprised you a little. We end with this topic of humility. And there's a little known trivia fact. I feel as though I've come full circle. But it is not known by many, but Tyler Wynn preached his very first sermon at the age of 15 on a Sunday night at the First Christian Church of Tyrone, Georgia. And guess what the topic was? Humility. So that was my very first sermon. I've come full circle. I hope this is not my last. And my mom didn't even remember that the topic of my first sermon was humility, which I was a little upset about. But I actually have proof. How many of you would like to see a clip of my very first sermon at the age of 15? Let's see if we can get that up there.
The utmost evil is pride.
Unchastity, anger, greed, drunkenness, and all that are mere flea bites in comparison. It was through pride that the devil became the devil. Pride leads to every other vice. It is the complete anti-God state of mind. And that sounds a little bit harsh. It sounds difficult. But from this chapter, and of course more to it and a lot of other parts to it, from this I realized that there was a problem in this world. There was a problem in me, and it was pride. Because early in my walk, as I began to be exposed to Christianity, I never really felt that I had done much wrong. I mean, have you heard the old, I never smoke or drink or chew or hang with girls who do? That was my life. I never did much wrong. I was a good student. I did, you know, what I was supposed to do most of the time. I came into this book, indeed that very chapter, thinking that I was a good kid. And I came away knowing that I needed grace. Because I never really wanted to skip homework or go to the parties everyone else went to or steal from the convenience store when it was easy. But the truth was that I was proud of that very fact. And according to this book, that was far more dangerous. According to tradition, so you won't quite find this narrative spelled out exactly in the Bible, but according to the way it's been told for a long, long time, the devil was once a beautiful angel in heaven, right? Right next to God with all of the other angels, and he was perhaps even more beautiful than most. But at some point he decided he wanted the praise and adoration due to God alone. And he started a war to get it. And from that, he was cast down to earth, still bickering that he was not recognized for his greatness. Telling that story is the only time in my life I've ever sort of, kind of, related to Satan. And I was ashamed of it. And funny enough, I related to a lot of other Bible characters in other ways as well. So if you've got your Bibles, I'd like you to open up to Genesis chapter 3. And Genesis chapter 3, if you are familiar with Bible text, is where the fall happens. Where Eve is tempted to take the fruit and bite into it. And we're going to focus in on verses 4 through 6, which say this: "You will not certainly die," the serpent said to the woman. "For God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." And when the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. And she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it. Notice the promise the serpent used to tempt Eve. "You will become like God, knowing good and evil." You can become like God if you take this piece of fruit. Now, honestly, do you really think that there was not enough food in the garden, that she was truly hungry and needed that fruit? This is not about what is pleasing and what will please our stomachs. This is about being our own bosses. No, I want that one specifically, and no one can tell me otherwise. This is about being our own God and having no authority over us ever. Because we are the highest thing in the universe, and no one will tell me what to do. And human history has continued its effort for all of its history to His effort to conquer everything and everyone around us and to become like gods ourselves. I believe, as C.S. Lewis said, that every sin that has ever happened in one sense or another goes back to our need to elevate ourselves and be like God, which is pride 101. Every sin goes back to that. In fact, I suspect that most of the people who say that they reject God out of evidence or they can't find proof or this or that, in most cases, I think that they actually reject him out of intuition, because they believe that there is nothing in this universe that can be above them. In the garden, we see that temptation to be like God, and it never stops. For instance, take Cain. Cain and Abel. Cain wanted God's praise and favor above his brother. He wanted to be elevated above someone else. It was pride. Joseph, with his coat of many colors. Remember, his brothers were upset with him because of the favor he received and because he told them about these dreams he had. And in those dreams, what was going to happen? They were going to bow down to him. And so they threw him into slavery, and he headed off to Egypt. Pride. And then, after they'd been in Egypt for a long time and built up a nation, and God decided to bring that nation out, it was Pharaoh who stood there hard-heartedly, refusing to let his people go, even as God rained down 10 plagues upon him and the nation. Because, my goodness, if you are the Pharaoh of Egypt, who's going to beat you? And after all of that, you go a little bit further, and Israel has this one pet sin over and over and over again. And what was that? What is it?
Idolatry.
And why does that matter? Because when you create an idol, like a little statue or something of that nature, you have created a god that you can control. A god you can grasp and maybe even put into your pocket and live as you want while God hides away in a corner. Idolatry is a matter of elevating yourself above and creating a god you can control. And I would ask, even though we don't have little statues anymore, have you done that? Have you ever created a god that you were in control of? If so, you have become something of your own god. Think of one of the great kings of Judah by the name of Hezekiah. Hezekiah, at the very end of his life, showed an envoy from a foreign nation, brought them in and showed them the treasures of his kingdom to demonstrate how God had blessed him so much. And this is one of the most righteous kings in the Old Testament. And it came back to haunt him because the envoys of that very nation returned years later, the nation of Babylon, and conquered Israel and took all of that gold out of the temple for themselves. And the leader and king of that nation was a guy by the name of Nebuchadnezzar. And if you read your book this week, you recall, Nebuchadnezzar stood on his balcony and looked up over all the world, and he said, "Look what I have done in my kingdom." And God struck him, and he was left eating grass in the fields until he learned humility. And you go further, and eventually Babylon is conquered by Persia. And Jeremiah, the prophet, throughout his book, is predicting the fall of Babylon. And over again, he says that they got what was coming to them because of their arrogance. They thought they were in control, but our God is. And over again, and so on and so forth. And every matter, and every sin is somehow about pride and becoming our own God and our own authority. But where it really gets dangerous, as if it didn't sound dangerous already, is when you start mixing pride with your religion. When you start mixing pride and faith. Because the most combustible evil, the most toxic combination in all the world is pride and religion. When you declare yourself right by God, and then take from that the fact that everything you do is justified, no matter how deplorable, because God is on your side, because you are proud, because He favors you, it is by that that wars are justified, and genocides are encouraged, and jerks are born. When pride is mixed with religion. And, you know, Jesus kind of had a perspective on that sort of thing. If you can open your Bibles again now to Luke chapter 18. We have a fairly well-known story here. It's of the Pharisee and the sinner, the publican. Verse 9, to some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everyone else, Jesus told this parable. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood by himself and prayed, God, I thank you that I am not like other people, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. That's kind of rude, isn't it? I fast twice a week and give a tenth of all I get. But the tax collector stood up at a distance. He would not even look up to heaven, but beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Jesus hated the pride mixed with religion aspect. It was his primary problem with the Pharisees. And you can see it over and over and over again. Because this is not about judgment. It is the fact that when you elevate yourself, you divide the world in two. And suddenly it becomes us versus them. Good versus evil and right versus wrong. And God favors me. And Jesus, you could go through the Gospels and name 1,000 times. Jesus accused the Pharisees of wearing long phylacteries. You know what that is? It's a piece on which is written a scripture, and you literally bind it on your body because you are so religious. He accused the Pharisees of loving to be called rabbi, which means teacher. I love it when they give me a title. He accused the Pharisees of sitting at the best seats at the best tables instead of taking the lower ones. He accused them of praying too long in public, of offering tithes for show with trumpet blasts, and of exaggerating their suffering while they were fasting to God. He accused them of throwing parties of some sort of cruel social category gamesmanship. I go to your party because I belong to this group. And so on and so forth. And even as the Pharisees continued to mix pride with their religion over and over again, all the while, they were doing things like ignoring the hurting, which Jesus pointed out time and time again, making no effort to save sinners, but being glad to condemn them and leave them out. He accused them of acting hypocritically, saying one thing and behaving a different. He accused them of being legalistic instead of seeing the heart of the law. And overall, harming Israel itself. And so instead, to fight that tendency of mixing pride and religion, instead, Jesus spent all of his time breaking every known barrier of that day and age. Speaking publicly to a woman at a well, making a Samaritan the hero of one of his stories, the Good Samaritan. Granting a miracle to a Roman centurion with a sick child. He ate next to tax collectors. He touched lepers and healed bleeding women. He healed on the Sabbath day. And he even gave a miracle to a Gentile woman, a Syro-Phoenician woman, who begged him for it. Jesus took a world of us versus them and made it just us. He was God in heaven who gave up throne rooms and eternity to bleed and cry and use the bathroom and be abandoned and die. And he did so likely naked on a cross next to thieves while the world jeered. He left no room for pride. Paul concluded it correctly. If you can now skip over to Romans chapter 3. He sort of concludes this idea of the grace of God, which he's been building up in the first three chapters of Romans. And he says this, we'll begin at verse 21. And here's the big revelation. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference between Jew and Gentile, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely by His grace through redemption that came by Christ Jesus. And now, skip down three verses to verse 27. Where then is boasting? It is excluded. Because of what law? The law that requires works? No. Because of the law that requires faith. For we maintain this person is justified by faith apart from works of the law. Paul looked at Jesus' life and saw that he was a living example of humility, to give up what was great and that he actually deserved, to come down to be with us, to die the way he did, and to give us a grace not based on anything we did, just belief in Him. And I think Paul was right when he said, boasting is excluded on those grounds. It's like the entire system is set up so that pride is excluded from human beings. Pride and our faith in God are oil and water. They don't mix. They cannot mix. It would be a violation of the very nature of things. Our salvation is by grace through faith, based on nothing we can do, but by the mercy of God and that alone. You and I are in the same category, God in one and us in the other. And that is all that matters. Have you ever, we often sing songs to say, holy, holy, holy is God. But do you know what holy means? Holy is to be set apart. Holy means that it's in a whole other category and it's different. And there's the category of holy things of God, and then there's normal people. And all of our little competitions on earth and everything we strive to do is like grasshoppers trying to see who can jump the highest. It really doesn't matter. It doesn't matter a bit. And yet we do it. And if we could realize the holiness of God, His separate, how separate He is, we could understand that we are all in the same category. I want to read another quote, actually, from the book. It kind of hints on this idea of mixing pride with your religion. In God, you come up against something which is, in every way, in every respect, immeasurably superior to yourself. Unless you know God as that, and therefore know yourself as nothing in comparison, you do not know God at all. As long as you are proud, you cannot know God. A proud man is always looking down on things and people, and of course, as long as you are looking down, you cannot possibly see something that is above you. And that raises a terrible question. How is it that people who are quite obviously eaten up with pride can say they believe in God and appear to themselves very religious? I am afraid it means that they are worshiping an imaginary God. They theoretically admit themselves to be nothing in the presence of this phantom God, but are really all the time imagining how he approves of them and thinks them far better than ordinary people. That is, they pay a penny worth of imaginary humility to him and get out of it a pound's worth of pride toward their fellow men. Those people who mix their pride with religion, he says, worship an imaginary God. And they elevate themselves above others. And it simply is not the way. It's like that idolatry. Creating a God small enough that we're still in control. Religion or faith in God and pride are oil and water, they can't mix. And I believe with all my heart, we ask this question in our small group. I don't know of any other system of thought or any other religion that emphasizes smallness in the way that Christianity does. Humility and leaving ourselves at a small spot, serving our ways into leadership and things of that nature. I know of no others that emphasize smallness like this. And it comes directly out of the life of Jesus. Washing the disciples' feet, being born in a stable, talking about service being the primary thing. And when they asked who was the greatest, who did Jesus tell them was the greatest in the kingdom of God? He called up a child. He emphasized smallness and service in a way that no one else in the history of mankind, to my knowledge, has. And I'm going to make up a word here, if you'll allow me. But this sort of thought is uniquely Jesusian. Uniquely Jesusian. I would say Christian, but people already have their meaning of what Christian means. And I'm afraid it wouldn't sound interesting. So this is Jesusian and Christ-like. To bring yourself to a small place to make God great and big. If you accept that there is a problem in our world, and a problem in us, of pride, if you believe that pride and religion are actually oil and water, and can't be mixed in any sense, and you believe that this is the unique way of life presented to us by God, I don't know exactly how to tell you how to do that. But I think I can tell you what not to do. So if you bear with me, I'm going to go on a little bit about what not to do. Don't insult yourself constantly in your mind, putting yourself down. That doesn't create humility. Self-hatred is never the goal. And honestly, I kind of learned that the hard way in my life. And you may have a similar story. I chose in my life to beat down this pride that I've been convicted of by playing that tape of all my doubts in my head constantly over and over again for too many years. When people complimented me, I convinced myself that I had tricked them. And they didn't know what they were talking about. The compliment meant nothing. And when I received awards for things in school, I became physically angry because it was stupid and I didn't need it. I did not deserve to eat enough to really be full all the time. And it was better that way because I could focus. And when people spoke to me and did nice things for me or even hung out with me, it was just they were doing me a favor. And I certainly couldn't be a minister Because all those people out there who told me I should be were just clueless. That's how I handled becoming humble. And it was the worst decision of my life. By the time I was a year into my master's degree, the United Nations would have classified me as malnourished based on my height and weight. Because I did that to myself. I went on not one, but three antidepressants. And I know that there are mixed feelings about these things, and I'm not trying to argue one way or another. I know that God is able to heal in so many ways. And I do believe that there's good things out there that can help people just get over the hump. Not fix everything, but just take the edge off enough. I stayed home instead of returning to school for one summer and one semester by doctor's orders. And when I returned, I was not allowed to live by myself. And I'm sorry to tell that story or admit that to you guys. Honestly, I've been dreading it. But I said in my article last month, if you read it, that I was going to be more vulnerable. So here you are. This is where I've been. This is the life that I've had. This is how I tried to handle pride. This is why it's the most personal topic in the book for me. But somewhere along the way, I learned a few lessons, especially two things. One, I learned that there was a difference between being selfish and being self-centered. Selfish people want everything to go their way. And they want to be happy in an unreasonable way, and they want everything to go like they see it. But a self-centered person doesn't have to necessarily want it their way. They just think of everything as revolving around them. Every thought, everything they do. And to be honest, in that period, I never really escaped the second one. Because even in the darkest throes of depression diagnosed, I was still thinking about myself in every one of those moments and how bad I was. And that's actually still, in a way, self-centered. And the second thing I learned is that when I got to that place, I was not a very good servant of God. I didn't do it very well. I became angry. I became frustrated. I hid away. And the whole point of the whole thing of beating down my pride was to try to be a good servant of God. That was the whole point. And I'd lost it somewhere in there. And so I had to give up. I had to let go of my principle of no pride / joy. Because I couldn't serve God that way. And when I gave myself the freedom, it was the most refreshing breath of air that ever came into my lungs. And I slept well for the first night in a decade. And by the grace of God, I took a lot of steps that I can promise you I am so happy in life, so happy to be here, so joyful to be a minister. It was one of those things that was in my path. And so I would not deal with pride the way that I did. That's my warning. But now as a minister, I still take captive every prideful thought that comes into my mind because it's dangerous as a minister. I'm still ultra careful not to allow the ministry to be influenced by this vacuum-like need I find in myself for praise and recognition from others. I won't let that be a factor. And the best way to do it for me was to simply focus on God's work and stop focusing on me, either good or bad, because it actually doesn't matter whether or not I can jump higher than all the other grasshoppers. It only matters that God is big enough to use even me. I want to read one more quote. And this is kind of the close of the chapter. And it means something to me, and I hope that you will hear it as well. Do not imagine that if you meet a really humble man, he will be what most people call humble nowadays. He will not be a sort of greasy, smarmy person who is always telling you that, of course, he is nobody. Probably all you will think about him is that he seemed a cheerful, intelligent chap who took a real interest in what you said to him. If you dislike him, it will be because you feel a little envious of anyone who seems to enjoy life so easily. He will not be thinking about humility. He will not be thinking about himself at all. Father God, I don't know if everyone can see it, but Lord, this was a difficult sermon for me. I mean, in one sense, I had fun looking back at the old clip of me preaching before, and God, I just know that I have been to such extremes in my life on both sides, and it's been hard for me to make sense of this. Lord God, I truly believe with all my heart that every sin goes back to pride in one way or another. And I truly believe that the most dangerous combination in all the world is our faith in you trying to mix that with pride. It ends up leading us to just justify every action so we can do whatever we want because, you know, you would approve. I really believe, God, that that is dangerous. And it's a whole other level of dangerous when you try and be a leader in the church and fight pride. Because then you have to go back to the passages about Jesus and servant leadership and washing the feet and reject the praise you might want in your soul and delay it for the praise of God one day. So by your grace and mercy, I truly believe this is the only system in the world, the only belief that would ever emphasize smallness and recognize it and celebrate it. Because you yourself did it, God. Jesus, you came down from heaven to a dirty world, died a dirty death to make us clean. You, Lord, are our example of humility.